to Roar Children's Ministries. Welcome all students from the school, all students from the church, any parents who are watching, and anybody else, welcome. We have a 10-second counter here on deck. It's going to give you some time to get something to eat, drink, do a bathroom run, get some wiggles out, and just get warmed up in general for worship, because that is directly following the timer. Okay, so here we go. Because here we go with our worship.
Philippians 4:8. Finally, brothers and sisters,
whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever it is admirable, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever.
Shout it out, okay? On the count of three. From the depths of your belly, I'm telling you. Here we go. One, two, three. Alrighty. So if you didn't know, now you know. So let's all do this together. Here we go. On three. One, two, three. All right, so let's just continue. I know we can't stay here, but we can continue to give a holy roar, talking about the Lord always and forever until, you know, he comes back or he takes us to be with him. But anyways, give him a holy roar every day, all day long, if you can. All right, so here we go. We got to open in prayer because we need God's help today, okay? Every day, but especially today. Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son, and by the Holy Spirit, we come to you in prayer. Lord, encourage us to worship, allowing our spirit to become a filter for our soul and flesh. Reveal to us any ungodly thoughts we may have and just remove them. Replace them with Jesus's thoughts. Help us to focus on anything that Jesus might be asking us to do, go, or say. Help us to surrender ourselves to a lifestyle of obedience and worship. Open our hearts and our minds to learn your word and what the Bible says about the change to our soul and flesh. Teach us what you want us to know about radical worship. And everybody at home said amen, and everybody here said amen. It is week number 4, and the title of our lesson today is The Change to Your Soul and Flesh, and it's coming out of the series known as Radical Worship, which is awesome so far. The kiddos in person, I actually get to see how they're responding and reacting to this curriculum, and they seem to love it as well. So I believe teachers and parents, will, if they're joining, and we'll just get a picture of what it's about, and we'll love it too, okay? So try it out. We're going to start with a memory verse, which is coming out of Galatians 2:20. And it is, but first of all, let me stop and say, hey, I'm going to say it, you're going to echo it, okay, or repeat it, just echo it. So here we go. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God. All right, so practice that. Get that in the depths of your spirit and soul. And again, it's going to come out, all right? And whenever you need it, and any way that you need it, it'll be there. The Holy Spirit will bring that back to remembrance, okay? So make sure it gets in you. We got to lay some groundwork before we jump into our lesson, so that way we know what we're jumping into, okay? So this week's lesson completes the foundational lessons of what worship is and what it does to our spirit, soul, and flesh, okay? There's more radical worship lessons coming up, but we've kind of laid the foundation, and we'll continue to build on to it. All right, children, all of our students in online, in person, we'll begin to envision a picture of our spirits as a filter for our soul and flesh. As we worship God, our spirit arises and begins to filter out all ungodly thoughts, emotions, and then replaces them with godly ones. This in turn affects what we do, what we say, and where we go in our flesh. A beautiful example of this process is Jesus in the garden worshiping God through prayer before he was to be crucified. All right, and through this story, the children will see Jesus's own struggle with the soul and the flesh of humanity and how his worship changed all of it. We will end the lesson by challenging the children to live a lifestyle of worship as Jesus did, allowing Christ to live through them, okay? So having laid that groundwork, let's jump in, okay? You'll see here a picture of a water filter canister or jug or whatever, pitcher, you know. And so if you haven't seen one before, the water goes in through the top, goes through this filter system, and comes out in the container pure, okay? And so having mentioned, you know, what a filter is, now that everybody knows, let me go on, okay? So we're going to be talking about, for just a little while here, the filter of our spirits, okay? All right, so as we continue to give God our heart through worship, touching heaven and allowing our spirits to be changed, our spirits become a filter for the rest of our body. All right, and so that's the filter that I mentioned earlier and described a little bit. As you pour water in this container, it first goes through the filter. What is dirty and impure in the water gets taken out, okay, and it's kept in there, and only the clean and pure water is allowed to go through to the container, all right? Still talking about the filter of our spirit. Our spirit is much like this filter for our soul and our flesh. If we allow our spirit to lead us, everything that comes at us in life will go through our spirit first, filtering out what is of God and what is not. All right, so I'm all have in person these signs, you know, I've got them here. And then I'm going to have them on some of the children. They're going to wear them, and they're just going to lead someone around, another volunteer around, all right, by the spirit or by the soul and the flesh. All right. So the spirit volunteer will lead the soul and the flesh. Today we're going to find out how our worship allows our spirits to rise up in us. Up in us and become a filter that affects change in our soul and in our flesh. Our soul, what we think and feel with, is a very powerful part of us. In fact, it only took one thought to create sin for all of humanity. In the garden, Satan tempted Eve to entertain and believe one thought that was ungodly, okay? And this led her to fall into temptation, and all of mankind has paid the consequence ever since. Thanks, Eve. I just want to say thanks, Eve, you know. But anyhow, moving on. However, we are no different than Eve, okay? We want to blame her, but we ain't no different, right? Right, right. We all have thoughts that come into our minds. Some are of God, and some are not. And here are some thoughts, okay? I bet we all have thought these before, all right? And so what I'm gonna do is have one of the volunteers to write these out on the board, all right? But some of them are, I'll read them, lies, hate, murder, stealing, slander, lustful thoughts, unforgiveness, pride, fear, anxiety, envy, and the list just goes on and on and on about ungodly thoughts, okay? Or thoughts that are not of God. And the question here becomes, what do we do with the thoughts that we have that are just coming in all the time, okay? Well, the Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians that we are to have the mind of Christ. So, how do we get rid of the thoughts that are not Christ's thoughts? Well, by allowing our spirits to become a filter for our mind. The Bible says in Ephesians that we are to put off concerning your former conduct, the old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Okay, and so you'll see that there's some changes happened in our thoughts here, okay? We're thinking about God and peace and prayer and faith and oh, happiness, kindness, love, joy, communication, self-control, family, sharing, teamwork, faith, patience, understanding. Oh, and the list could go on and on and on, but those are some good ones, so, and worth mentioning. Moving on, though, just like the water is renewed by the filter, we are to be renewed by our spirits. Our emotions, the other part of our soul, most always are directly related to the thoughts we're thinking. And if we get our thoughts right, our emotions will be right too, okay? Which is awesome, okay? Problem solved. Woo! Moving on to worship changes our soul. All right, and we'll see here in this picture Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane where he is praying unto the Father. Okay, it takes worship and more worship to allow our spirit to rise in us and be activated as a filter for our soul and our flesh. The best example of how this worship process happens to change our thoughts and our emotions is through the story of Jesus in the garden found in our Bibles in Matthew. Okay, and if you haven't got one yet, get with me and we'll get you one. Thanks to a donor, we're able to distribute them to kiddos who come to church and are alive and in person. Okay, and so, but moving on. Jesus knew his time was at hand to be crucified. And in the garden, we see Jesus struggling with the thoughts of humanity. Jesus said, "My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death." He said that in Matthew in our Bibles. But what Jesus did next with those thoughts and emotions would restore what humanity had lost with Eve in the garden and set an example of what we are to do with the struggles of our thoughts and our emotions, okay? Jesus decided to worship God and to allow his spirit to become the filter for his thoughts and his emotions, removing what was ungodly and replacing them with the mind of God. All right? Jesus told the disciples that he was going to pray and asked them to pray with him. Okay? He fell on his face and prayed, saying, "Oh, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." And immediately through Jesus' worship and prayer, we can begin to see the change in his mind. But it took more than one moment of worship. In fact, it took three times of worshiping God to bring complete change. The third time worshiping through prayer, Jesus said, "Rise. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand." And that's found in the Bible and Matthew. Suddenly, Jesus' thoughts and emotions were replaced with God's. Okay, and so just truth, lovely, pure love, life, excellent, humble God, peace, forgiveness, Jesus. Honor those type of thoughts, okay? God's thoughts. And in our Bibles in 2 Corinthians, it says, "For the weapons of warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ, and being ready to punish all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled." Our greatest battle with the enemy is in our mind. And our greatest weapon is our worship coming out of our hearts, the depths of our hearts, unto God, that allows our spirit to arise and become a filter, casting down the thoughts that are ungodly and replacing godly thoughts. Worship changes our flesh. That's what we're going to be talking about for a couple slides here. The Bible says in Romans, "Put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lust." And that means we are to be in our flesh as Christ was on this earth in the flesh. And so I'm going to place a white t-shirt over one of the children with a label that has Christ on it. All right, we'll do that in person. But if you're at home, you can try some of these things, okay, that we say we're going to do in person at the church. If you can't make it there, then do it at home. All right, but anyways, we are to do, say, and go as Christ did these things. Once again, We see in the story of Jesus in the garden how worship affects our flesh. Jesus struggled with ungodly thoughts and emotions that affected what he wanted to do in the flesh. The will of the Father for him was to be crucified, but in that garden, Jesus was struggling. I mean, he's struggling inside himself with fulfilling the lust of his flesh, which was to not experience any pain or death at the hands of the people. But the third time, he worshiped through prayer. Jesus stood up and was willing to go. His flesh and his soul had lined up with the Spirit of God within him. His worship strengthened his spirit, causing his soul and his flesh to submit and to change their direction. Okay? Big change. Big change. As Jesus physically went and was willing to crucify his flesh, Jesus asked us to do the same. He says, take up the cross and follow me. All right? Jesus isn't saying that we, our flesh, must literally die on a cross or even pick up a cross like this. But what he is saying is that we must be willing to go, say, and do as Jesus has done. Peter said this about his life in the Bible. It says, he says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives through me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God. And that's in Galatians, the book of Galatians in our Bible. Peter was willing to die to what he wanted to say, where he wanted to go, and what he wanted to do. Instead, he allowed Christ to take over his very flesh. In closing, somebody shut that door. I'm about to shut mine, okay? Jesus himself on earth demonstrated this type of fleshly surrender when he said he only did and said what he saw his Father do and say. Because of Jesus' willingness to crucify his own desires of the flesh, everything he did, said, and everywhere he went became an act of worship. Jesus lived a lifestyle of worship to God, and so should we through Christ. Having finished the lesson, let's focus in on our God and words to the following song. And let us just worship him for who he is and all he has done as we sing and dance, expressing our heart's reverence, love, and devotion to him. Here we go.
Whoa!
And that brings us to our salvation prayer. And the opportunity is being presented to you to get right with God through belief on Jesus Christ and to become a child of God and to have that opportunity to just glorify Him and magnify Him and exalt Him and love Him for the rest of your life. Okay, and so beginning now. And if you have that desire, okay, to just, you know, get to know God a little better, let's pray this prayer together, okay? Dear God, I know I'm a sinner. I ask for your forgiveness. I believe Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe that Jesus died for my sin. I believe that you raised Jesus to life. I want to trust Jesus as my Savior. I want to follow Jesus as Lord from this day forward. Lord, guide my life and help me to do your will. I pray all of this in the name of Jesus. And everybody at home said amen, and everybody here said amen. If you sincerely sought God for forgiveness, know with assurance, without a doubt, that it has been given to you. You are forgiven. You are His child, okay? You are welcome into the kingdom of God, all right? And the family of God. But you can't stop there, okay? You can't, you would be stopping short, all right? And so I don't want that for you. I don't want that for me or anybody I know. So I'm gonna give you some next steps to take, okay? The next steps would be to read your Bible. Again, if you don't have one, I'll get you one, all right? Begin to start talking to God in prayer, okay? And then also, I advise you to get a good godly mentor. So if you have any questions about God and your life and how it's lining up with the Spirit as we're walking along with Jesus in this journey called life, you could ask, you know. And then also worship. Just give your heart's love to God extravagantly, okay? Because He is worthy of that and more, All right. And then get into a Bible-believing, God-fearing, spirit-filled church. Is somebody, somewhere where you could serve, somewhere where you could grow, okay, and in your relationship with God. All right. And so those are the next steps that I recommend you take, all right, so that you grow in your spiritual relationship with God versus die, okay, because those are the options, all right. Sword drills. We've got the scriptures from the lesson listed here. The kids are going to get them in their activity bags when they come in person for service. But get those in you, all right? Look them up yourself in your Bibles, all right? And just confirm and reassure yourself that what you heard is the truth. And study and meditate on those and just get them in your spirit, okay? And here's some more. We've, again, they just pulled these out of the lesson. It's nothing, you know, that I've done, but they were there out of the lesson. And so all worship related. Take home is also going to be in the activity bags, and it's about worship as well. And I'm going to read them so that the kiddos have, like, it's a little summary of our lesson. And so be real fresh in their mind, the important things of it, okay? And then we have some questions down below that they should be able to answer if they have listened intently and participated in things like that. They should be able to answer these. But if not, review. You know, you have the, this is recorded video, and so you can just fast forward, reverse, blah, 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 you know, just keep doing it until you can answer the questions. And then they're probably also going to be found, you can find the answers to them by looking up the scriptures. And so let me just go ahead and read this. As we worship and touch heaven, our spirit arises in us and becomes a filter for our soul and flesh. We all have ungodly thoughts and emotions. It is what we do with them that counts. Jesus himself demonstrated for us in the garden what happens to our thoughts and emotions when we worship. Worship changes how we think and how we feel. Worship also changes what we do. We are to crucify our flesh and allow Christ to live through us. All right, so question number one. What happened in the Garden of Eden to Eve that affected all of humanity? Okay, all right, you should know this one, hopefully. Okay, you know that. But anyhow, number two, how many times of worship through prayer did it take Jesus for his mind? Okay, just a hint, all right, and emotions to be changed, all right? I just gave you that one, but hey, this one, you're going to have to find it on your own, all right? Name one battle you have had in your soul and flesh recently. Did you choose to worship during that time? You answer that, okay? All right. Testimonies, prayer requests, and needs. If you got them, bring them, baby, because we ain't scared, okay? And we like to celebrate with you what God is doing in your life. And we can help. We can join you in prayer. And also, as a church body, we can try to meet some of your needs. So just bring them, okay? Just bring them. Bow your heads, because we got to close in prayer. As much as I enjoy this lesson, we have to go on to the next one. So bow your heads, close your eyes. Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son, and by the Holy Spirit, we come to you in prayer. Lord, thank you for encouraging us to worship, allowing our spirit to become a filter for our soul and our flesh, for revealing to us any ungodly thoughts we may have, and for removing them and replacing them with Jesus' thoughts, helping us to focus on anything Jesus might be asking us to do, anywhere he wants us to go, or anything he wants us to say, helping us to surrender ourselves to a lifestyle of obedience and worship. Thank you for opening our hearts and our minds to learn your word and what the Bible says about the change to your soul and flesh. And thank you for teaching us what you want us to know about radical worship. And everybody said amen there, and everybody said amen here. Till next time, know that I love and I miss you, and that I hope to see you soon. There's kiddos that are coming back in droves, okay, all right? You know, I'm just like, my goodness, there's so many kiddos in here. And I love it. But there are some that I still ain't seen come back yet. And I'm just saying this right here, right now, okay? Just come on, baby, come on. All right, so until then, stay healthy, safe, and strong. I love and miss you. I hope to see you. Remember, read, pray, worship, serve. Also, you did a remarkable job, and I didn't give no stamps. I didn't even give any stamps in the last class. Everybody was so good. I was just like, oh my goodness, totally forgot. But anyway, Lord, and it is, it's got a little cross on it, and it's yellow, okay? So nice and bright, knowing that He is our sun, okay? All right, and shines in, He's our light that shines in our lives, all right, and through us, all right? But anyhow, you did a remarkable job learning today. Here's a little something to worship that hopefully will help you to surrender yourselves to a lifestyle of obedience and worship. I love you.
I can't hear from you.
If I didn't hear,
then I know what
to do.